Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again, folks, to this new day. I mean, I'm really having some tough times. I've been running some darn hard. But anyway, welcome to the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. There's all sorts of things going on, right? We've got a presidential campaign. We've got all kinds of things that have been happening to us. There was the National Black Congress Association dinner last night. And I guess it's my understanding that, but President Obama was there. That was his last speech before this particular group. There were some interesting things that were being said at that group meeting. I thought it was very interesting. But there are other things that are going around. And that's what we're going to do. As I indicated in the last show, we're going to follow up. We're going to make sure we educate you, inform you to this whole political arena that we're in at one point in time. Very, very important. It's very unique. It's very unique at this point in time. So, with that, I'm going to my second guest now, this time around, is Lanita Dukes, Grassroots News.
So he's the one that puts the S on my last name. I don't have an S on Duke, but that's all right, Bruce. If I can get a word in edgewise when you speak, that would be a revolutionary.
You really?
Yeah.
Oh, well, then I may call you Duke. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that's my last name.
No, it won't happen. Dukes.
Okay. Well, I'm very glad. It's always a privilege and pleasure to be on stage with you, especially if I can say 10 words.
Well, I'm going to give you. I'll give you 9 today.
Okay.
But no, in all due respect, folks, I've invited Lanita at this point in time because she too can talk to the history of the last 8 years that we've had with, i.e., the first African American as president of the United States. It had an impact of anything, from a national standpoint, even from a local standpoint. But things were happening local too, during that particular time. And Lanita was here. She had a show called Grassroots News on KBOO. FM aspect of it. In fact, I was there at one point in time. I had my show too.
In fact, I'm still on the air and they're thinking of expanding my time. But, you know, before we went on the air here, you spoke about the congressional or the Black Caucus dinner last night.
Right. What do you think about that?
I thought it was interesting. Mr. Broussard made a wonderful point. He said, and I'm paraphrasing,
yeah, no problem,
that there were not a lot of young people or new faces in the audience.
And or the diocese.
That's very interesting because that is why we have the Black Lives Matter movement. Mm-hmm. Because traditional Black organizations were not addressing issues that people felt should be addressed, such as the issue of police community relations, police shootings, and that is what led to the Black Lives Matter movement. Because, you know, as you indicated, the traditional organizations, NAACP, Urban Leagues, they're just not addressing those issues.
Right. And the politicians. And the Black politicians.
You're absolutely right. They're not addressing it.
They still rate as part of the majority group. You know, they're running about 13%. And, you know, you got all these folks there. You know, I love them dearly. You know, we worked hard, if you will, to get them there.
Right.
But when they got there, they tend to have forgotten what were the issues that got them there to begin with.
Well, you look at what's going on locally with County Commissioner Loretta Smith.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, she's endorsing opening Wapato as a homeless shelter. Mm-hmm. And you and I both ran. I ran for city commissioner, position 1. You ran for mayor during the course of that campaign. And we're only talking about 4 or 5 months
ago. That's right. I was there on it.
You said open Wapato. Yep. Wasn't that your position?
Big time.
My position was open Wapato. All of a sudden, it's her position. Months later, when it's relatively safe to say, let's open Wapato. So now we're going to have to start calling her Loretta X. She wants to open Wapato a little late to the game, but at least she's addressing this issue.
She got it out there.
But the reality is, and I know you disagree with me on this, I think she's doing that politically to position herself to run for a city council seat in 2018. You heard it first.
But you know, Lanita, I got to say, you're right. In all due respect, you know, she said, I chatted with her for a moment. In fact, I gave her respect by calling her up when I noticed it was in the Portland Tribune about the whole issue of Wapato and say, hey, awesome. You know, I mean, what's going to happen? What about Deborah Cafori, you know, who's the chairperson? Is she going to bring it before the commission and you guys going to vote on it? She said, no, Bruce, I'm having some tough times trying to get Deborah to bring it to the floor. That's when you start bringing up the money. the money starts getting to the table aspect of it. So everybody wants to build new structures. Mm-hmm. Everybody want to build stuff downtown to keep it going. Because the bottom line, when you look at Wapato, and I'm just sharing a part of the thought when I was campaigning for that, as far as my platform, you can't imagine the number of services that are associated with the homeless. You got millions of dollars that are associated. And that's why I kept trying to understand, why is it that we can't find out who's on the street? No one would want to.
They know who's on the street. You have long-term organizations, social service organizations, such as JOIN, such as Transition Projects. And this month, they open up a new women's shelter, Human Solutions Shelter for women. Additionally, they open Hanson's Shelter, where the old sheriff building used to be on 122nd and Gleason. So they do know how many folks relatively that are on the streets.
Yeah, but many of those services are pretty well dependent. Their funding is depending upon a certain number. And I'm saying that number is smaller. Once you process these folks, you'll find out there are many other people there. There are folks that might have divorced or just want to hang out on the street or this, that, and the other.
Well, there's also a tremendous need for affordable housing.
Oh, yeah.
So you have people that technically maybe shouldn't be classified as homeless when, in fact, all they need is affordable housing.
Exactly.
They want housing in the city, but because of this rental crisis, we're pushing people out East County.
Yes. And then that same point, you think, here's Wapato, they figured about 500 beds or so better, but the property around is fantastic. You can expand that in it as much as you want to on either the right side or the left side. It's a beautiful piece of property, and it's away from the city. You know, in all due respect, when you think about the city, the downtown city of Portland, you think about, it's like a living room, so to speak. You know, at the end of the week, you like to just kind of hang out somewhere. You can get on the bus and go downtown and sit on the water, you know, blah, blah, blah. You can do this, that, and the other. Why do they want to have individuals that are out there, in all due respect, laying out on the streets, really in a sad situation? Yeah. You don't look at this stuff. Get them out of there. But better yet, what about the mental illness? I mean, I would think that's what the county does.
Human services, right.
Aren't you part of that process?
What do you mean, man?
Aren't you part of that? Aren't you working for the county? I thought you were part of the county.
No. I'm just a poor black woman.
Oh, no, don't give me that. No. The county, that's one of their jobs.
Right. Within the city, the county takes care of human services sorts of issues.
Yes.
Right.
They should have basically opened it up just for mental illness, if that's the case. They got to clean that stuff off right off the bat.
Yeah, but it took a city policy. Now, wait, we have a mayor, Mayor Charlie Hale. He's the one that endorsed people temporarily sleeping outside. So it was a city policy that allowed people to feel that they could camp on the sidewalk.
No, he's not the new mayor. He's not the mayor.
No, he won't be after November,
Once the election went through and it was identified as Ted
Wheeler. Yeah, but this was his previous policy, Charlie Hale's previous policy.
No, but didn't he do this? He did that after Wheeler got elected.
No, he did this before Wheeler got elected.
Okay.
And now we have new mayor come November. But it was Charlie Hale's policy that emboldened people to sleep outside.
All right, well, I'm going to give you that one. But as far as I'm concerned, as soon as that election was over with, we have two mayors.
Now.
It's Wheeler's responsibility.
Wheeler will take over
in
November.
It's Wheeler's responsibility. Right. There shouldn't be this big lag time, if you will, of 7 months or so before the person gets sworn in as the new mayor. This guy is he's on vacationing right now. Someone told me he was on his sailboat the other night.
Well, some people feel he was on vacation while he was in office before the election.
Well, they do that all the time, you know. That's why.
Well, you have to wonder about his policies. Well, you know, his policies help create this situation where you have people laying down downtown. You call it a
big time
dining room environment who are laying down there butt naked or talking to themselves, who are in need of mental health treatment.
Big time. Big time, big time.
Now, the issue with Wapato, are we going to have the same situation that we've had with Wapato, where you refurbish it for the homeless people and then run out of money to staff it with people, run out of money to actually use the facility? Now, remember, Wapato was supposed to be a jail, right?
Yeah, but my point is it's perfect for a mental illness.
Well, they want to remodel it.
For what?
To a homeless shelter.
For what?
a homeless shelter.
Oh, really? So why are we trying? Why are we building all these? This idea of building these homeless shelter on the water and stuff downtown.
Well, that
in the middle of winter.
In the middle of winter.
In the middle of winter now. Okay. Right, these right. folks, they're not going to have that thing complete until
well,
about next
summer.
Well, it's
been challenged and
those folks
challenged.
Going to be sitting on the street, laying out in the water, and all this.
I don't know if it's going to happen.
I mean, using the restrooms all over the place.
Yeah.
But you're going to straighten that up, though. I guess you're going to straighten that up.
I'm going to straighten that
good,
up.
Good, good.
Well, again, I think that it's interesting that Councilwoman Smith is pushing this proposal through while she was in office for 8 years.
Right.
You can probably count on one hand and subtract two the number of initiatives that she started.
Right.
And the number of people she helped. There are a lot of people, because, you know, Portland is a fairly small community.
Right.
And many times people have gone to her for help, and she's the first one that says, no, I can't do this. That's outside of my jurisdiction.
Okay.
So here you have a person. That's her MO in the streets.
Right.
And now she wants to somehow use good faith and her experience and get in a city politics.
Right.
I don't know. Look at Jules Bailey. He resigned from a good job where he was representing the people in his district as a county commissioner. He resigned to run for mayor. He was on the campaign trail with us. And what I learned from observing him is that the issues that city council or county government deals with are not the issues that city hall deals with, mm-hmm. what the people are involved in.
Mm-hmm.
In the city, people want to know about housing. They want to know about jobs. County commissioner, like, you're right, Bruce, they deal with more human service related issues.
Yeah.
Those issues don't translate well from one political structure to another.
Mm-hmm.
Jules Bailey didn't do as well as expected on the campaign trail for mayor.
That
given
kind of got
all
me
the that. Money that he had.
And the support. He had the police
and the support.
He had Portland police support.
He didn't do as well as many people expected.
He
and I think the issue was and is that...
Is that just a kind of an entree, so to speak?
City council issues do not translate well in city government. It's a totally different population, a totally different demographic. Additionally, in Portland now, remember, we have at-large voting. So you have folks on the Hill are going to vote the same way that people in St. John's vote for one or two candidates. It's not broken up.
Well, I mean, you know
what? By district. It's not district
you know what my feel was when that
in
happened?
In the city.
Well, you know what my feel was in regards when they brought Jules in?
What's that?
Was to cut us out. The other folks who were running. People like myself, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? Had a little bit more background on what the city is all about, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's Jules. He's number two guy. Willa basically brought him on. Ted Willa recognizing him big time. And all due respect, I wish the guy all the luck, but I'm gonna be right there with him, if you will, on him, so to speak.
Okay.
But the fact of the matter is, he really doesn't have the background about what's going on in this city. I'll say that to you right off the bat.
Now, who doesn't have the background?
Willa.
Okay.
He's elected.
The elected mayor doesn't have the
elected
background.
Elected background does not have the background. He had the money.
Yeah, he had the money.
He had the money, but he didn't have the issues. Now, the other 14 candidates that ran, I could say right up front, they had background.
Mm-hmm.
These folks were addressing serious issues.
They addressed
very
a lot of
issues.
Serious issues.
And in fact, what he should have done on this whole issue of homelessness, he should have kept those 14 people there and had committee meetings and gotten their feedback and feel for how should we solve the problem of homelessness.
If you were the mayor, you would have done that.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
your style. That's not his
style. No, but I'm going to still do that. We're going to still do that, right? You're going to be on the commissioner, and I'm going to be I'm the mayor now. You know what
right.
I mean? We'll be but anyway, I'm just throwing this on the side aspect of it. But we have problems with leadership. That's all over the country, for that matter. I mean,
talk about the national
let's
campaign.
Talk a little bit about
this. Is amazing. I can't believe it. It's like, I just, flummoxed. It's the most amazing time to be a historian. It's
yes, it
the
is.
Most
it's
amazing
oh.
time to be a journalist
oh.
to see what's going on.
Fantastic. I'm glad we're in the mix.
And am I a basket of deplorables? What a...
Oh!
Why?
Well, why did you bring that one up? Why did Hillary Clinton... Why did she make that statement? I mean, she put us all in there. In fact, she even put Jews in there. That's the first time I've heard the Jews in there. But right up front, they've been having their issues too. She put the Muslims in there. She put the blacks in there. She puts the Hispanics in there. She puts the, I mean, just.
That's not what she said, though, Bruce. She said that people